Welcome to The Faith Alive, a series from the Diocese of Harrisburg that explores and explains the basics of the Catholic faith. Last week, we started our discussion on the Eucharist and looked at the actual process of turning the bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ. This week, I'd like to spend some time reflecting on how you and I should act when in the presence of the Most Holy Eucharist. You know that we Catholics show a variety of signs of reverence in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament, in the presence of the Eucharist. We genuflect toward the tabernacle when we come and when we leave the sacred place of our churches. The candle is glowing, the sanctuary lamp nearby the tabernacle, to remind us that the Blessed Sacrament is reserved. And just as we would greet a friend if you passed someone on the street that you knew, or you entered the home of family or friends, just as we have certain courtesies that we pay toward one another if we pass a friend on the sidewalk or enter the home of some friends or close family members and loved ones, we may kiss, we may hug, we'll certainly say hello, we may shake hands, but there are certain courtesies to greet one another. Well, here we're coming into the presence of our Savior, Jesus Christ, truly present in the tabernacle, in the mystery of his real presence in the Eucharist. And so it requires from us a gesture of acknowledgement, humility, and worship. It's not just a handshake or not just a wave hello, but rather we genuflect in an act of humility and adoration, to acknowledge that I have just come into the presence of the Savior of the world, the incarnate Son of God, who is really present here in this church. The same as when we come forward to receive the body and blood of Christ at Holy Communion. We're asked to make a bow before we receive the sacred gifts. And that bow, again, is an act of humility and acknowledgement in the real presence of Jesus. They are profound signs of courtesy and acknowledgement that our Lord is truly present before me, and I need to show that, not just knowing it in my mind, but show it bodily. See, we are such an incarnational church in our Catholic faith. We talk about smells and bells sometimes. We use sounds. We use incense. We use different colors. We have our artwork and statues, many things to engage our senses. And so we worship with our bodies and our voices. And so at times we sit, at times we stand, at times we kneel. Our body needs to be involved in this incarnational worship of God. And so using our body by genuflecting, bowing, kneeling, we are showing reverence to the mystery of Christ's real presence. We need to prepare, and I'm sure you do, and each of us get, I think, perhaps into our own habits, but it's important to prepare ourselves to receive the Most Holy Eucharist. And I often ask in my own prayers after Thanksgiving, Lord, never let me take for granted or grow indifferent to this sacred treasure of the gifts of your body and blood. Those words just come out so easily because I've said them I don't know how many times. Because it would be easy to become indifferent or somewhat calloused in the act of receiving Holy Communion. And one way to avoid that is by good preparation to receive Holy Communion. Certainly an examination of conscience to be sure that we're not guilty of any serious sin, a mortal sin that would kill the life of grace in our souls. And if we find that that might be the case, then in his mercy, the Lord has made available to us the sacrament of reconciliation. And that's certainly the best way of preparing to receive Holy Communion whenever we know we need absolution of serious sin before we approach the Eucharist. Because St. Paul told us, of course, to receive the Eucharist unworthily is to eat and drink a judgment on ourselves. And so we need to be careful that we are properly disposed to receive the body and blood of Christ in Holy Communion. And then as we're waiting to receive, I think words of welcome You know, Lord, prepare me to receive you under my roof. I am not worthy. But that's the prayer that we all say together when the priest holds up the chalice and the host, having been called to the banquet of the Lamb. And we recognize our unworthiness. And yet Christ chooses the unworthy, as we see so often in the Gospels. And he wants to come under our roof. So some gratitude, I think, coming from our hearts as we process forward with our fellow Catholics to receive Holy Communion. So those are some ways, I think, that we can prepare ourselves. The sacrament of reconciliation, a good examination of conscience, and then expressing our gratitude and asking the Lord to help us always be acutely aware, never to become indifferent to this most precious gift. There's been an interesting change since the Code of Canon Law in 1983 about the frequency of receiving Holy Communion. Prior to the Code, in fact, when I was studying in the seminary, you could receive Holy Communion as many times on a given day as you attended a different Mass. So, for instance, on a Saturday, if you went to the parish Mass at 8 a.m., you could receive communion. If you went to a funeral in your parish at 10 a.m., you could receive communion. If you went to a nuptial Mass at 2 p.m. in a parish, you could receive communion. And then you could go to a Saturday evening Mass and receive communion at that Mass. That would be four times in one day that it was legitimate to receive Holy Communion. The 1983 Code changed that, and I think perhaps with some real wisdom, because too frequent reception of the Blessed Sacrament might make us, what I was saying a little earlier, become a bit maybe indifferent or take for granted this amazing gift of our Lord's body and blood and his real presence. The new Code of Canon Law, Canon 917, says that you can receive Holy Communion and then receive it again. Now, the Latin word in that canon, 917, is iterum, I-T-E-R-U-M. And it caused a great stir when the code was promulgated, because iterum can mean once again or over again. So no one knew exactly what this canon was saying. People were able to receive it over and over again prior to the 1983 code. So what did they mean? Once again? Or over and over again. This canon, 917, was the first canon of the new code to receive an authentic interpretation from the Vatican. There's a special commission that interprets legislative text right under the authority of the Pope. Since he's the chief legislator, he's also the chief interpreter of his legislation, and they act in his name. So the very first interpretation was given regarding that word iterum for canon 917, and it was that you can receive once again. So we may receive Holy Communion twice in one day, provided that the second time is within Mass. So, for instance, I often give this example when I was teaching this very thing in the seminary. If you were taking care of a shut-in in your home, and say the Eucharistic minister came at 9:30 that morning to give your loved one Holy Communion, and you received, because you would think, I'm not going to get to Mass today, I have to be here. And maybe an hour later, a family member stops by, and you weren't expecting that visit, and they say, oh, I'd be happy to stay here with Mom until you can go to the noon Mass. And you go to the noon Mass. You've already received communion from the extraordinary minister of Holy Communion, and now you can receive again. That's the iterum, a second time, as long as the second time is within Mass. There's one exception to this where you can receive a third time, and the canon mentions it, and that is Holy Viaticum. If later in the day, having received Holy Communion twice, you were to become seriously ill and able to receive the sacrament of the anointing and Holy Communion, we call that Viaticum, you could receive possibly a third time on the same day. That would be a very big exception, but nevertheless, it's explicitly mentioned in that canon, 917. So typically, we can receive Holy Communion twice in one day, so long as the second time is also within Mass. Thank you for joining me, and until next time, may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Amen.